Hi, I'm Buriana and you're watching Art Unplugged. This video is about Rembrandt, one of the greatest artists who ever lived. I'm sure that all people who watch this channel know who Rembrandt is, but I asked several of you the question, why is Rembrandt important? This is what the viewers had to say.
But I know that he was a master, but who also was prolific, managed to make a ton of paintings that were still brilliant.
Pero si yo pienso en Rembrandt, lo que me viene a la cabeza son pinturas oscuras y con mucho contraste.
Well, for me as a photographer, his importance comes about because of the way he used light, the way he had light fall across people's faces.
Една от причините, според мен, да я считам за много важен е тази, че той поставя човека и до голяма степен на човешките страдания в центъра на своето творчество.
И тази голяма амплитуда като шпагат между барок и тази реалистичност за мен е едно от важните неща в творчеството на Рембрандт.
All that was said is right. But then, here is what the great sculptor Auguste Rodin said when someone compared him to Rembrandt.
Compare me with Rembrandt? What sacrilege! With Rembrandt, the colossus of art! We should prostrate ourselves before Rembrandt and never compare anyone with him.
These are pretty strong words from the author of The Thinker and the Kiss. So there must be something more than Rembrandt's realism and treatment of light that provoked them. Let's see what it is. Rembrandt was born in 1606, the son of a well-to-do miller in the university town of Leiden in the Netherlands. He lived and worked during the Dutch Golden Age, a period when the Dutch became the leading naval and commercial nation of Europe and the world, and enjoyed great wealth and prosperity. When Rembrandt was 8 years old, his parents sent him to the Latin school in Leiden, where he received an education that few children could hope for, even in affluent circles. At the age of 14, he had already decided to be a painter. Rembrandt trained first in Leiden and then with a master in Amsterdam, where he could learn the technique of the Italian masters and particularly the chiaroscuro of Caravaggio, the dramatic contrast between light and dark. Rembrandt was an exceptionally talented artist who took everything he learned to a new level as he developed his own style. In the manner of the Baroque, he used a limited palette and deep shadows that disappear into obscurity, an uneven golden illumination and highlights painted with bold, dashing strokes. Sometimes he used an abundance of paint, sometimes very little, and sometimes he scratched the canvas with the handle of his brush. Something very unusual for the time, which favored smooth, well-blended surfaces. As a young artist back in Leiden, Rembrandt realized the importance of etching and dedicated a lot of time perfecting his etching technique. In etching, a drawing is made on a copper plate covered with resin by scratching it with a needle. After that, the plate is immersed in acid, which eats into the scratched areas. This can be repeated several times till the desired depth is achieved, and then the image is printed on paper. Because etchings could be produced in series, they were cheaper than paintings and were the best means for an artist to advertise his talents. Rembrandt transformed the etching process from a relatively new reproductive technique of the time into a true art form. And curiously enough, during his lifetime, he was more famous as an etcher than a painter. This is his famous etching, Christ Preaching. Notice the masterful choreography of the scene, the range of dark and light, and the array of human characters. You only need to look at their reaction to know what Christ was talking about. Rembrandt's early work was noticed by a prominent dignitary and he moved to Amsterdam, the teeming capital of the Dutch Republic. By the time he was 30, he had already built a successful career as a portrait painter, married a wealthy girl, bought a large house, and started collecting art and valuable objects. He had a studio with apprentices in his house and worked incessantly. But after the death of his wife in 1642, Rembrandt's popularity with the public started to decline. His excessive spending got him into debt, and 14 years later, his creditors sold his house and put up his collection for auction. The worst of it was that the Guild of the Painters banned men in his situation from practicing the trade. To save him from utter ruin, his mistress and his son set up an art dealing firm, where Rembrandt was formerly an employee. However, both she and his son died before him, and at the end of his life in 1669, Rembrandt left no other property than some old clothes and his painting tools. Like many artists of his time, Rembrandt painted portraits, biblical and mythological scenes. But there was something special in his way of doing that, and I'm not talking about his handling of paint or light. Like Shakespeare, he was able to get into the skin of all types of people and to know how they would behave in any situation. Rembrandt had an outstanding ability not only to depict very natural, realistic human figures, but to portray deep feelings, imperfections, and vulnerability. Whether the context of a work was myth, religion, or society, Rembrandt painted human beings and their emotions. This is his painting of the biblical tale of the Supper at Emmaus. According to it, the resurrected Jesus revealed himself to two of his disciples in the town of Emmaus, only to soon vanish from their sight. Rembrandt chose the moment when Jesus disappears before the disciples' eyes. But how to show the disappearance of a body, since as a painter he could only show what is visible? Rembrandt's solution was to represent Christ as a shadow, a silhouette against a brightly lit wall. So all the focus is not on Christ, as was customary, but on the man. We see the impact of the miracle on his face. Rembrandt chose to tell the story not through the God Jesus, but through the human. Why? Because we are naturally disposed to empathize with the fellow human in front of us. And this is the essence of Rembrandt. He always sided with humanity and human emotion. This is another biblical tale painted by Rembrandt, the return of the prodigal son. The son has returned home in a wretched state after wasting his inheritance and falling into poverty and despair. He kneels before his father in repentance, begging for forgiveness, and the father receives him with a tender gesture. Notice the difference between the hands of the father. The left appears larger and more masculine, while the right is softer and feminine. They seem to suggest mothering and fathering at once. Standing at the right is the prodigal son's older brother, who crosses his hands in judgment. In the parable, he objects to the father's compassion for the sinful son. Rembrandt painted many portraits in his life. Some were commissions for clients, others were people around him, and about 100 were self-portraits. In his portraits, he reached a depth of insight that no one has surpassed. To illustrate my point, I will draw a comparison between Rembrandt and other masterly works of portraiture. This is a work by the great portrait artist Hans Holbein the Younger, who lived about 100 years before Rembrandt. The colors, the rendering of the flesh, and the details of the costume are perfect, but the man is stiff and posed. He feels distant and guarded. This is a man who does not reveal much to the viewer. And this is a work by Rembrandt. Not only we feel in the presence of a real human being, but it is as if the whole story of his life is somehow transmitted to us. This is a portrait by another great Dutch master, Frans Hals, who lived a generation before Rembrandt. Quite different from the Holbein, isn't it? It is incredibly lively and engaging. We feel like we are in the middle of a conversation with this man. It has the immediacy of a snapshot, but it belongs only in the moment it captures. Now look at this portrait by Rembrandt. In this quiet face, we can see all the complexity of this man's personality, his wisdom, his suffering, his vulnerability. And the more we look, the more it reveals to us. Like Holbein and Hals, Rembrandt seemed to indulge in his painterly virtuosity. Look at the rendering of the face and the play of light on the different textures. But then, when he decided that the painting has achieved its objective, he left the hand in the glove as a mere sketch. He famously said that a painting is finished when the artist decides it is finished. In Rembrandt's great portraits, we feel face to face with real human beings. We sense their warmth, their need for sympathy, their secrets and suffering. He didn't care for the beauty of a face. Wrinkles, thinning hair, and even the double chin of his beloved wife are all on display. The quest for humanity is what Rembrandt was obsessed with, and eventually this led to his decline. It was beyond the comprehension of his contemporaries. What they wanted from a portrait was to give a good likeness and reflect the sitter's social status and idea of themselves. Rembrandt's penetrating eye gave them a kind of honesty and insight they were not ready to face. It was too much for them. But there was no alternative for the master. Here is what he said.
I can't paint the way they want me to, and they know that too. Of course you will say that I ought to be practical and ought to try and paint the way they want me to paint. Well, I'll tell you a secret. I've tried, and I've tried very hard, but I can't do it. I just can't do it. And that's why I'm just a little crazy.
Rembrandt left many great works of art, but for me his greatest masterpiece are his self-portraits, which I see as one work of art, an ongoing project of introspection by a genius, a silent autobiography of a man's dreams, ambitions, love, glory, vanity, wisdom, loss, defiance, loneliness. And if we have to come back to the question I asked at the beginning, why is Rembrandt important? My answer is, because through his work, he created a material expression of empathy, the uniquely human ability to understand and share the feelings of another living being. Rembrandt was twice a genius, once for his exceptional talent for empathy, and twice for his ability to turn his insight into the human condition into magnificent works of art. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like, share and subscribe, hitting the bell sign in order to receive notifications of my future videos. You can follow me on social media if you want to see what I do as an artist. Thanks for watching, and I shall see you soon. Bye.